It's really like a dream. So as you're coming down the list, I couch my lance, I'm bringing it down my opponent, slowly, 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 and then bam, you hit. And that's when that dream turns into a nightmare.
The crowd goes crazy!
Today, we're at the Pacific National Exhibition, the PNE, with a champion, with a owner, with a full contact fighter in a sport, in a full contact fighting sport that you probably never heard of, full contact jousting.
Well, I think everybody's heard of full contact jousting. It's just the concept and the idea mixing around in your brain going, oh, it can't really exist nowadays.
Exactly.
Like, sure, it was a training for warfare back in the Middle Ages, but for people to do full contact jousting in the modern age, does it really exist? You know, it's got to be fake or choreographed or a dinner show.
Vegas
or medieval times dinner theater chain. But no, yes, this is 100% legit full contact jousting. The jousting that we do, of course, is by far the most extreme style of jousting out there in North America, let alone the entire world right now as it is. And it all started from a childhood dream.
So that was your childhood dream?
It was my childhood dream. Growing up on a horse farm in Acton, Ontario, Canada, for me, it was, you know, I was a little cowboy. And
sure.
I was always involved with horses and equine sports. But at 4 years old, I remember watching a movie with Errol Flynn. It was, you know, Robin Hood.
Okay.
Robin Hood came out to save the Black Knight, who turned out to be King Richard at a jousting tournament. And before that time, it was all about, you know, robbing from the rich to give to the poor. Robin Hood was my idol. And then I saw the joust in that movie, and it was done. Of course, I raided the tinfoil cabinet, made myself a barrel helm, cardboard shield, jumped on an Arabian, and realized you shouldn't just jump on an Arabian with tinfoil and a cardboard shield. It's not going to go well for you without the training.
So you did do like the dinner theater thing back
Correct.
In the day.
Yeah, so
The choreographed
shows. I actually was one of the first Canadian knights in the show there in Toronto at the Medieval Times Dinner Theater. Had a great experience, a great time being there, but the whole time, I had a childhood dream, and that was to be a knight in shining armor, not a knight in shining polyester and tinsel.
Right.
So I left the Medieval Times Dinner Theater world and started harnessing my own show together using full chainmail and the surcoats and the great helms. And we were jousting still in a choreographed manner, but everything was a little bit more real. And then out of the blue, I get a phone call to see if I wanted to represent Canada in the first international jousting championship in North America. It was a legit competition as being held by the Longspeak Scottish-Irish Highland Festival in Estes Park, Colorado. At that point, I think it was the second largest Scott Fest in the world, realistically. And, of course, one of the biggest in North America. I went to that competition just as a promoter, I'd never had any real experience jousting. I was just living a childhood dream, so I thought. And I went there as a Canadian.
Did you have a suit of armor at this point?
No, I had chain mail and stuff like that, but I did not bring anything with me to that competition. I only went as a promoter. And as soon as I got there, the English jousting team from the Nottingham Jousting Association, the Humphreys family, Philip Humphrey, the world champion at that point in time, he had won the last championship that was recognized as a real jousting competition in France for England. It was 1984 or 86 or something like that, around that period of time. And this is, of course, you know, 10, 15 years after. And he came out of the barn, he had his entire team with him. He said, "Oh, you must be the lad from Canada. It's great to have another person here representing our monarchy." And it's like, "Well, I'm not really here to compete." He goes, "Well, your name's on the list." So I wasn't about to paint Canada yellow. And it turns out, they coaxed me to get into the competition.
So I never had any formal training at jousting?
Never had any formal training of real full contact jousting whatsoever.
So you keep on going on about full contact jousting.
Correct.
Can we just make a differentiation between full contact and not full contact?
There's many different associations out there of jousters. There's the IJA, the EJL, the IJL, the European Jousting League, the ABC, the DFT, go through the alphabet. There's an association that involves jousting. But the majority of these, and well, majority meaning all of them, they joust with a balsa wood a scored balsa wood tip. So it's a 4-foot tip on the end of your lance. And when you ride down, whether you're jousting in crotch or jousting with a targ, like different shields that you would be mounting to your breastplate, the lances are exploding. Truly historical fashion, because the lance is back in the age of the Renaissance, when jousting was more of a tournament aspect, not a training for warfare. The lances were fluted and made to break.
Okay.
You know, the lances were custom made to break on impact, because the nobility didn't want any deaths or anything. And even though it did happen, they didn't want any of those injuries. They didn't care really about what the public thought. They either cheered or got their heads lopped off. You don't even see that it was that case. So here it is now, enter the modern day and age. And all the audience here is coming here to the P&E in hopes, in a sick and twisted way, in hopes that we're actually going to joust for real, meaning that we're not going to have balsa wood tips, meaning that the lances are not going to be scored and made to break in such a fashionable way. But actually, we're going straight forward using solid wooden lance, whether it be pine or Douglas fir or hemlock or even hickory for that matter. We've used solid wooden lances, 11 foot long, that takes upwards of about, say, close to 2,000 pounds of force to break. And we are breaking those
lances. You're breaking them all the time.
On each other.
So the PSI there, the tip of that must be like an inch or two.
So it's basically the copper cap that we put the Cornell on the end of that lance to prevent any of the splitting in case of a headshot. That copper Cornell is 1¼ inch plumber's cap. So just for people at home to be able to identify what we have at the end of those lances, it's that $7.50 copper cap. And that, of course, the lances are transferring that energy through that copper cap, which is 1¼ inch, right into your opponent's body.
So, stupid question. What does it feel like to get hit by a lance?
Yeah, well, do you know what? And it's not a stupid question, because many people, of course, even the people that do it, you know, the theatrical style, the IJA, the EJL, all of those styles of joust, yes, sometimes they can receive a hit forceful enough to unhorse themselves. The difference is, in our sport, it happens quite frequently because of that deliverance of force. So if you're lined up striking somebody as true as you can, then honestly, it feels like you're getting hit in the chest by a 100-pound sledgehammer as you ride by. And that is the amount of force. Like, sometimes you get hit and the armor does its job and it's like, that was nothing. Right. But then other times you get hit
and you wake up tomorrow.
You wake up 3 days later in a hospital going, what the hell hit me? And that is the
that has happened to you.
That's the honest to goodness truth. I myself have never been hit and woken up in a hospital, but I've seen it happen to other people. There have been many times that I've been hit that my body has gone into shock. Whereas, like, I'm just trying to capture my breath. Meanwhile, I'm looking at the sky, looking at the grass, looking at the crowd, looking at the sky as I'm somersaulting through the air and onto the ground. It was 16 years before ever getting unhorsed. So
that was a good run.
That was a great run. It was all because of my horse. I actually have him tattooed on my chest, a dragon. He was a Percheron. He only stood 15-3 hands. So he was like a smaller Percheron. But he was very aggressive as a stallion, and he threw his weight into the hit. So when we gave hits, it was just like him throwing his body weight into it as well. And when I'd receive big hits, and if I was coming over to the side, he'd scoop up underneath and pick me up.
Okay.
So again, it shows the relationship between knight and his horse. If you just have a horse that goes down back and forth, okay, that's one thing. Great, you have a good jousting horse. But if you have a horse that can pick you up on, you know, underneath a hit because you're going off balance, you come up underneath you, that's a true partner. And in this sport of full contact jousting, you definitely need to have a partner, a teammate, you know, underneath you, a best friend for that matter, to help save you and at the same time help you become a star.
So your experience notwithstanding, because you didn't have training before you went and jousted.
No, I did not.
But what does training consist of?
Training consists of, first, of course, competitors involved in jousting have to be physically fit. And on top of being physically fit, they have to be mentally fit. So you have to know going into the sport that it's going to be one of the most grueling styles and types of training you've ever experienced. Of course, I had that TV show on history called Full Metal Jousting. And I had guys from the UFC, who I can't mention via contract, come out and try their hand at training. And after 3 days, there was nobody left. I had some top college pro football players who were going pro come out and try for that TV show as well. None of them made it. So it's kind of unique to see the 16 people that made the TV show were not really the most physically fit or the most, athlete, the biggest and the strongest. What they were, however, were the most dedicated mentally. And of course, to have that, you have heart, and that will push you through any type of training. Now, what was really unique to see was the different platforms of the competitors that had come out. We had, guys involved in Western, like Western riding. We had guys involved in dressage riding. We had guys involved in hunter jumper, big, small, it didn't matter, short, tall. We had people come out from all different diverse backgrounds. And to see a world champion cowboy like Rope Myers, who won a gold medal in the Olympics, has the current reigning, champion for the PRCA bulldogging record, struggle, that should show a little bit more legitimacy to the amount of training and strength and technique needed for the sport of jousting. So again, first off, you have to be physically fit. More important than that, you have to be mentally fit. And then on top of everything else, you have to be an equestrian.
Right. I'd imagine that without extensive background in horseback riding, you're going to have to get that first.
Correct. The horse riding is the most important thing. I'm not saying that, some guy sitting at home right now, sitting on the couch, who's never ridden a horse before, can't get up on a horse and pick up a lance and charge down at somebody. Sure you can.
Right.
The question is, are you going to be able to pick yourself up out of the dirt and continue on learning about the sport without getting the proper training? And yes, jousting is dangerous. Yes, it is very extreme. But with the proper training, the danger level is lowered. And with the proper training, the technique is there. So you're able to become properly skilled as a full contact jouster.
Is there any defensive element to it? Like, can you slip, dodge, parry, or do you just sit there and take it?
No, unfortunately, in this sport, it's man versus man, and or woman versus man, for that matter. You have to square up, and you have to present a shield. It's kind of dishonorable if you dodge or parry or try and deflect the lance away. You're opening yourself up for receiving that full hit of, God knows how many, like 2,500 pounds of force coming at you at 30 kilometers an hour. You are going to get hit. It's just a matter of when and how bad. However, with that said, the greatest defense in this sport isn't even better offense.
Right.
So if you're able to be aggressive, you're able to get in there, you're able to lunge and push forward into the hit, then you're also giving yourself some defense because of that offensive line.
Because you're not grounded, but you're attached to your horse.
Correct.
And the force is going into the horse as opposed to taking you off the back.
Correct, exactly.
Okay. I would love to get into the specific details of this. And I think we're going to save that for another day because I know you got shows and a giant crew to manage.
Yeah, of course, yes. Yeah. We're here at the P&E. We're here for the full 15-day run, 3 shows a day. I have 6 competitors that are competing right now. The world champ, current reigning world champion, Charlie Andrews, he's out of the competition with a major concussion. Happened yesterday.
I saw him yesterday and he was fine.
Yeah, well, guess what?
Not fine anymore.
Not fine anymore.
Oh, damn.
So I'm not sure if he's going to be able to come back, but hopefully in the next three, four days, let the swelling go down a little bit, and hopefully he'll be able to pick himself up out of the dirt.
Was that a shot to the head or falling off the horse?
It was a double unhorsing. So, and that's the unique thing. It happened, yesterday, second last show. And he was going up against one of our younger guys, one of the newer guys. And, in this sport, you always have to be prepared and you can never underestimate somebody. And not to say that Charlie underestimated him, but that hit took him by surprise. Both of them came off. And unfortunately, the footing here was not properly, fluffed up the way it should have been. And he hit the ground pretty hard, and neither of them got back up on their horses after that show. It was a pretty devastating hit. But with that said, we're here for the full time. So yeah, I've got a big crew here, and they need to have some time off. And I'd love to take more time to talk to you and about the sport.
I'd love to get into the details of the historical jousting versus modern day jousting versus the role in battle. And we'll save that for another time.
Yeah, I think we touched on it a little bit, but if your viewers are interested in learning more, well then, by all means, send in their questions as well, and we can hook up again and answer those questions, and I can answer those questions for them.
Can you describe, just as we're closing here, the feeling of riding? Like you've done how many jousts?
Well, geez, this whole thing started with me. Yes, jousting did exist in North America, but it did not exist at this level. So a lot of people are calling me the godfather of the modern day sport of full contact jousting. And of course, I appreciate that. However, I'm just a little kid living his dream, and this was my vision, and this is the way I have it. And a lot of people think I'm crazy, and a lot of people overseas probably, you know, don't even know me, hate me because I have this style of jousting in existence. But of course, this style of jousting, well, ended up with two TV shows, Knights of Mayhem on National Geographic.
Oh, you've been on ESPN, yeah. National Geographic, yes. Outdoor Life Network. I mean,
you've done your homework.
Featured on the New York Times.
That's right. I was in New York Times. I was featured as North America's biggest jousting star and most dedicated promoter. And all of those things are great, but really in truth, and this is for everybody, you know, I don't have some big ego. I'm good at what I do. I have passion for what I do. And I think that makes me even better. Now, with that said, to be a jouster, requires that great amount of control. If you go into the sport and you're aggressive, you're going to miss off target. If you go into the sport, which is kind of like an oxymoron, like you're going into this sport, a competitive sport, and in most competitive sports, you got to get yourself amped up so much that the rage and the aggression is flowing through you so you can deliver the most powerful hits. Well, in this sport,
your accuracy will go.
Your accuracy is gone. If you don't hit that target and if you can't bond with your horse, then you're a sitting duck for disaster. So in this sport, it's more of a find your zen and be able to be one with your horse and rely on your technique to deliver the most effective, powerful hit that you can. And that is what makes a full contact jouster. Now, how does it feel? Well, it's kind of strange because it's kind of like a dream. When I get on the horse and I go out, yeah, the crowd's there and we do our little, pre-show, just teasing the crowd, a little bit of a warm-up. But when that helmet goes on and that lid shuts down, I wear a sparrow's beak helmet. When that lid shuts down and I now look through it's like I become a different person. The crowd goes away. And I start bringing my aggression down and I calm myself down to the extent that I can even feel my horse's heartbeat, which is so weird to say that because you can't really feel it without a microscope, right? But I fully get into that focus and the lances get handed up and I feel the lance and I'm set and ready. I come around the corner as you can hear you can hear, but you really don't hear. You only see the signals of the squire crew on the ground that your opponent's coming around or he's received his lance. And you square up at your opponent, you see him 200 feet away, and you start charging. Now, as you start charging, though the joust happens in 3 seconds, it feels like you're going 20 seconds down that joust list before you even couch your lance. So I let my horse take his 3, 4, or 5 strides, depending on the timing, depending on who I'm going against, because I'm constantly studying their riding, their seat, their position on that saddle, their targeting. So again, there's a lot of science behind the sport as well. Technique is the same as a fighter watching a boxing match and seeing, okay, well, that guy, he leads with his shoulder, he drops his head here. That's the time to tag him. It's the same thing with the joust. You have to study that footage. You have to study your opponent. But most importantly, again, you have to regain that control. And it's really like a dream. So as you're coming down the list, I couch my lance. I'm bringing it down my opponent slowly, 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 slowly. And then bam, you hit. And that's when that dream turns into a nightmare. That quick. And then all of a sudden, it's like, okay, broken lance, pull the lance up and away from the horse, so it eliminates any danger. Am I falling off? Adjust my balance, adjust my seat. And then as I realize that I'm still on my horse and I'm still in control, I'll reach down, go ahead, gently pull up the reins, and that horse will stop where he's supposed to stop. And that was a joust, just like that.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for describing.
Thanks, guys. Thanks. Look forward to talking to you again.
Good luck with your touring and your, yeah, your competing.
We're all over the country this year. So just 4 weeks ago, we were in Sydney, Nova Scotia at Center 200. And then we stopped off in Ottawa and then stopped off in Chatham. And then we stopped off in Indianola, Iowa at a big county fair. And then we hit Texas, then Boulder, Colorado, then Brooks, Alberta. And then we came right over here 2 days after. So
Are you off to next?
Well, let's see. We have people in the Utah State Fair this weekend. So, of course, we had to divide the group there. And then, our, of course, our home base, which is our big Renaissance Festival in Dayton, Ohio, called the Ohio Renaissance Festival. It's a fantastic event there. They probably have upwards of around 40,000 people attending that event. And, of course, the Joust is the number one show there, the main event. And we get on often probably close to 6,000 people per show watching that joust. So I actually have some of the guys from the TV show Full Metal Jousting going there to run that show for me while I'm here at the P&E.
Well, people can follow you and your knights and your company at Extreme Jousting.
Yeah, extremejousting.com, knightsofvalor.ca, knightsofvalor.com, Valour, V-A-L-O-U-R, .ca. Awesome, the Canadian spelling. Awesome, guys. Thanks. Bye-bye.
If you want to make sure that you get future episodes, please go and subscribe. You can subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, Google Play, wherever you get your podcast from, there'll be a subscribe option. If you do that, then you won't miss out on future podcasts and you'll also be helping it grow. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.